Hey everybody, it's Rhonda Freeman from Neuro Instincts, and today I want to talk to you about the trauma bond, the brain, and survivors of abuse. Now, there's quite a bit going on in our heads when we are going through the process of a trauma bond. And the chemical that is most important in this process is oxytocin. Now, is it the only chemical associated with the trauma bond? No, definitely not. But it's the only one that I'm going to focus on today. Oxytocin is a neuropeptide and it's a hormone. So it has actions in not only the brain, but also in the body. And it's involved in sex, it's involved in bonding, connection, trust, but it's also associated with processes like envy. Oxytocin is what's known as a contextual responder. And let me give an example of what that is. A contextual responder means that it acts in different ways based on the social situation. So for example, when I get a hug from my friend or a cuddle from my dog, or a kiss, this person has a very calming and positive effect on my brain and body, and that is anxiolytic, meaning that it calms anxiety. But if I'm in a bad situation, and for example, I'm with a mate that is not good to me, or I'm in a situation where I'm just really unhappy, the oxytocin in my brain will actually rise, and one might think, well, okay, oxytocin rising is a good thing. That means it's going to calm your anxiety. But no, not in that situation. When oxytocin rises in response to a bad situation, it's alerting you that something bad is going on, and it's alerting you that your social situation isn't good, and it wants to motivate you to change it. So oxytocin rising in that situation is called anxiogenic, meaning that it raises anxiety, makes you not feel so good. So with that information in mind, anxiolytic and anxiogenic, I want you to listen to my explanation of my hypothesis regarding the trauma bond.
I suspect that the information just shared is related to what lies behind the trauma bond, at least partially, because I strongly suspect there are contributions from dopamine as well. As you might already be aware, a trauma bond is established when an abuser exposes their partner to mixtures of kindness and meanness. It is inconsistent and therefore behaviorally very reinforcing to the person who is targeted. In fact, intermittent reinforcement is one of the strongest approaches to ensure certain behaviors are repeated. Take, for example, slot machines. They don't pay out every time, nor do they pay out never. But they pay off sometimes. You just have to keep investing in them until they do. Well, this is often what happens to a victim of abuse. They stay, not because of some logical decision, but often because they are trauma bonded. Now, of course, factors such as financial issues, housing, children, fear of the partner are strong contributors as well. But for this lecture, as you know, I'm focused on the brain component. So what does the trauma bond have to do with oxytocin? Well, I have a suspicion that victims of narcissistic and psychopathic abuse might get exposure to both forms of oxytocin, each delivering a different message. When the partner is kind, or when there's non-violating sex or a comforting touch, then the calming, bonding oxytocin receptors are in action. However, when the partner is callous and mean, then the anxiety-producing receptors are in action, alerting her that this is a poor quality connection. Her relationship is filled with back and forth, roller coaster variations in treatment. When she tries to leave, even if it's leaving and disconnecting emotionally, the anxiety-producing receptors pull her back toward the social bond that was lost. She can easily become stuck in a vicious circle. And this often answers the question of, why does she stay? Now, keep in mind this neurobiology of the trauma bond is a hypothesis I have. I would love it if researchers could explore this and see if this hypothesis bears out. But it may be some time before we see a study such as this, because oxytocin is difficult to measure and know for sure the levels that are present within the brain.